I've flown in the substratosphere in a fortress bomber over Holland, France, Norway and Germany. If the people on the ground in these countries have seen us at all, we've appeared no more than the tiniest dot in the sky. Their largest towns have seemed to us no bigger than the sardine tin laid flat on the perspex. On your first ascent, you are very much aware of flying in unexplored space, relying completely on oxygen, but after a few trips, you soon become accustomed to new colours in the sky, and when from one point, only 100 miles off the English coast, you can see right across Denmark and into the Baltic, into Germany by Hamburg, and the whole plain of Holland is spread out in front of you, you do little more than note this in your log. To us, who have carried out a good many attacks on the enemy from the substratosphere, our fortress seems no more difficult than a good old Lysander at 1,000 feet. It's just a question of what you get used to. Before coming to our attack on Emden last weekend, I should like to give you two instances of why we have learned to trust the fortresses. I was in the fortress which was attacked by 7 fighters when we were returning from Brest. 3 minutes after our bombs had gone, the fire controller called out that there were 7 enemy fighters coming up from the starboard quarter 1,000 feet below. They closed in, and there was almost no part of the fortress which was not hit. Some of my friends and the crew were killed and others wounded. Petrol tank was punctured, bomb doors were thrown open, flaps were put out of action, tail tabs shot away, tail wheel stuck half down, brakes not working, one aileron was only just slightly good, the rudder was almost completely out of control. The centre of the fuselage had become a tangled mass of wires and broken cables. Square feet of the wings had been shot away, and still the pilot managed to land the fortress on a strange aerodrome. There's a testimony to the makers in America. Another time, we were coming away from Oslo, and part of the oxygen supply ceased. The pilot had to dive down swiftly through 19,000 feet. He pulled out, and the fortress landed safely at base. There is proof of the strength of the fortress's construction. Fortunately, these thrills are rare. Our attack on Emden last weekend was almost without incident, except, of course, for the dropping of the bombs by the Spurridge site with wonderful accuracy on the target. It was, in fact, a typical fortress raid. We lost sight of the aerodrome at 2,000 feet and never saw the ground again until we were off the Dutch islands. Foamy white cloud, just like the froth on the top of a huge tankard of beer, stretched all over England and for about 30 miles out to sea. The horizon turned, quite suddenly, from purple to green, and from green to yellow. There was a haze over Germany, but I could see Emden 50 miles away. I called out to the pilot the sort of jargon we used in the air. Stand by for bombing. Bomb sight in detent. George in. Okay, I've got her. Then the pilot said to me, okay, have a go. The drill is that I push a lever on my left for the bomb doors to open, and on a dial in my cabin, two arms move out like the hands of a clock to show me the position of the bomb doors. On and around the Sperry site, there are 11 knobs, 2 levers, and 2 switches to operate. On the bombing panel, there are 5 switches and 3 levers to work and an automatic camera to start. I keep my eye down the sighting tube, which incidentally contains 26 prisms, and with my rest, I work the release. As the crosshairs centered over a shining pinpoint in Emden on which the sun was glinting, the bombs went down. The pilot was told by means of an automatic light which flickered on as they dropped. We were still 2 miles away from Emden when we turned, and one of the gunners watched the bursts. Almost a minute later, he told us through the intercom, there you are, burst in the center of the target. And back we came through those extraordinary tints of sky. Over England, there was a strange scene that I've noticed before. The cloud formation exactly compared to the land below. Every bay and inlet was repeated in the stratocumulus cloud thousands of feet above, like a canopy over the island. During the whole sortie, I had only one thrilling moment. I saw a Messerschmitt coming towards us. He seemed a sort of improved type, and I looked again. It was a mosquito that got stuck on the perspex in the takeoff and had frozen stiff. The windows are usually splashed with insect blood, but this little fellow seemed just the right shape for a Hun. Otherwise, it was uneventful, typical fortress trip with a temperature minus 30 degrees centigrade.